Tonight, People Icons presents Heroes and Survivors.
On the morning of October 14th, 1987, 18-month-old Jessica McClure was playing in her aunt's backyard when the toddler fell 22 feet into a dry well shaft.
And now a story which millions of Americans have been living with today. Tiny Jessica McClure fell into a small abandoned well in Midland, Texas.
Jessica fell into this 8-inch wide hole to an abandoned water well.
Frantic rescuers attempted to reach baby Jessica in a space only 8 inches wide.
Sophisticated oil drilling equipment was rushed in, and workers began a shaft parallel to the well.
Millions watched around-the-clock live coverage as the drama unfolded.
The child is entering her eighth hour of a nightmare.
Eyes, the hearts, the minds of people around the world have been on Jessica McClure underground in Midland, Texas.
The rescue captivated the nation as one of the first ever 24-hour news events.
Oxygen and warm air were quickly pumped into the well.
Jessica.
Rescue workers were able to hear her cry.
People were watching it on television all over the country, all over the world, really. We wanted her out, and no one could quite figure out how to get her out.
Residents were eager to jump down the shaft and do their best.
But the rescue mission was extremely difficult. Crews had to dig through hard rock alongside the well in order to reach baby Jessica.
As they continued to chip away at the rock, paramedics were able to reach in and touch Jessica. But they just could not make the hole big enough with jackhammers to get her out.
Rescue workers say they had hit a rock, they needed more equipment, and they say now it will be several more hours before they can get Jessica free.
She hasn't had anything to eat or drink for more than a day. The medical personnel on the scene say they don't want anything passed down to her for fear she'll choke.
They recently heard the child saying nursery rhymes and actually singing to herself. 18-month-old Jessica McClure appears to be one tough toddler.
Millions of people have been following the effort to rescue Jessica. The 18-month-old baby has now been trapped in the bottom of that dry well for more than 2.5 days.
Jessica's mother stayed by the well while her daughter actually managed to sleep in the hole.
Finally, the moment the nation was waiting for.
We interrupt our regular program schedule to bring you a special report from ABC News. Here is Ted Koppel.
Jessica McClure has become the most famous 18-month-old child in the world. You're looking at a live shot of what I hope will very soon, within the next few minutes that is, be one of the happiest scenes that anyone in America can hope to see.
After 58 hours of being trapped in the 8-inch wide well, baby Jessica was lifted out safely.
It's just absolutely electric. People have the biggest grins I've ever seen.
It's hard to describe how that story captured the imagination of the country and the world.
Jessica became known as everybody's baby, captivating the hearts and attention of millions.
We took it very personally, as if it were happening to one of our own.
From the efforts of some heroic men and the grace of God, we've got our baby back.
It's funny because Jessica doesn't actually remember her time in the well. She remembers the time after and the effect that all the publicity really had on her family. But she wanted to have her own life and not be defined as the girl in the well.
30 years later, Jessica is married with 2 children and has made a completely normal life for herself.
Yeah. We moved out into the country. I work at the school that my kids attend.
And today, she's still known around her town as Baby Jessica.
The term Baby Jessica, it is still an everyday thing. I have people that's how they associate me.
Although she doesn't remember her time in the well, she has the scars to remind her of that harrowing night.
My right leg was stuck up above my head, like in a split, for 58 and a half hours. Left foot down, right foot up. I have a scar on my forehead. I have a bald spot in the back of my head that you can see.
When Jessica turned 25, she received money from a trust fund, donated by supporters who watched and waited for her safe return.
It's amazing that people would come together like that to donate money to a child that was not theirs, that they did not know. It's an amazing feeling that people cared that much.
Today, she is thankful to be alive.
It could have taken my life, but it didn't. I got on my side that day.
The outpouring of support for baby Jessica was remarkable. It was Austin Hatch who faced unimaginable adversity in his life all before the age of 20. He has the rare distinction of surviving not one, but two plane crashes.
In 2003, we were flying back to Fort Wayne, and the plane unfortunately crashed.
Austin and his father, Stephen, who was piloting the plane, survived. But his mother, Julie, and two siblings, Lindsay and Ian, did not.
My dad threw me out of the plane, saved my life, and went back in to get my other family members, and unfortunately wasn't able to.
Austin was only 8 years old, and in one tragic day, the Hatches went from a family of five to a family of two.
To survive a plane crash at the age of eight is just like such a horrific experience.
It's about one in 1.2 million flights that you would encounter an aircraft accident. It's a miracle that he survived.
Austin and his father recovered from the crash and their loss one day at a time.
And my dad just kind of taught me how to persevere and how to overcome. And that was one of the most valuable lessons I ever learned from him.
They shared the love of basketball and used it as therapy.
We put one-on-one in the driveway after he got home from work. That was the highlight of his day, was just being together.
A few years later, Stephen Hatch remarried, and Austin had a new family, stepmom Kim and three siblings.
Austin really got back into his life afterward. He did well in school. He became a star basketball player. He had really put his life back together.
Austin excelled at basketball and caught the eye of Coach John Beilein from the University of Michigan. Coach Beilein even offered Austin a full scholarship at the age of 16, something that made his father extremely proud.
He was so happy for me and so proud of me because he knew everything that I invested in it.
Just 9 days after the Hatches celebrated that scholarship, Austin, his father, and Austin's stepmom, Kim, got on a plane to head to Michigan, where the unimaginable happened again.
And an Indiana high school student is fighting for his life today after surviving the second plane crash of his life. 16-year-old Austin Hatch is in critical condition after his small plane, piloted by his father, crashed in Michigan on Friday.
Stephen and Kim died on impact.
Austin lost half of his family in one plane crash and survived, and then lost the other half in a second plane crash and survived. It is heartbreaking, but also so miraculous.
Austin managed to survive, but was in critical condition.
The fact that he was able to survive the first one, let alone a second one, is astronomical. It's a miracle.
As far as the injuries is concerned, I had a lot. Fractured skull, punctured lung, broken this, that. Who knows? I don't even know them all. But the biggest thing was the brain injury. I had a massive brain injury.
As he laid in a coma for 8 weeks, doctors said because of the severity of his brain injury, Austin might never walk or talk again.
When Austin woke up from the coma after the second plane crash, he found out he'd not only lost his father and stepmother, but he'd also lost a lot of his athletic abilities. So it changed his whole future.
Well, I don't remember the vivid details, but I was laying in the hospital bed and I couldn't get out of bed and walk.
But that didn't stop Austin.
Good job, Austin. Fantastic.
He worked tirelessly to relearn how to walk and talk, and eventually play the sport he loved. And after years of physical therapy and hard work, Coach Beilein honored his scholarship, and Austin did the impossible.
How about this? Austin Hatch will check this. That's what a moment for Austin Hatch. Beilein gives him a big hug.
I think being able to recover from the injuries that I suffered well enough to the point of where I could get in the game for Michigan is a pretty cool thing.
It was a truly miraculous feat. But after participating in a couple of games, Austin realized he wasn't completely at the level he once was and made the tough decision to give up his spot on the team.
And we just kind of decided that this is the best thing for me and for my future, you know, to really focus on my studies more.
Austin continues to support the basketball team and has found love.
I have a wonderful girlfriend and her loving family, and I have great teammates and coaches and great extended family and my grandparents and aunts, uncles, cousins. So yeah, I've lost a lot, but I'm very, very blessed to have all the family that I do.
And after everything he's had to endure, Austin continues to look forward and has found a way to give back.
I've been getting into motivational speaking a little bit, but I really enjoy it.
I encourage you all to discover, find, and embrace your purpose.
I really enjoy sharing my story and taking a negative and turning it into a positive and using it as a conduit to help other people.
He's not angry about what happened to him. He's heroic by not being a victim. Austin is like the ultimate survivor story.
It's all about what you do for other people, and if I can, you know, give a little inspiration by how I live my life after tragedy, that's awesome.
Coming up, the mom who risked it all, facing off with a tornado.
We have a particularly dangerous situation.
Not once, but twice.
There is a God in heaven. I need your help because I'm done.
And later, you'll never believe the first responder who saved this man from a massive heart attack.
To people icons, heroes, and survivors. Our next story has captivated the nation. Stephanie Decker is a mother who risked it all to save her children.
We have a particularly dangerous situation. Tornado watches out.
We have several tornadoes on the ground.
March 2nd, 2012, tornado warnings hit Henryville, Indiana. While husband Joe was stuck at work, Stephanie Decker picked her children up from school and rushed home.
Head to the lowest level of your home. Please be in your place of shelter now.
I sent her a text and I said, there's a tornado, get in the back of the basement.
Staying in touch with Joe by text, Stephanie and her young children, Dominic, who was 8, and Reese, who was 5, went to the basement to seek shelter, or so they thought.
I texted and said, you guys okay? Are you guys okay?
And then I heard this noise, sounded like a train was about to run over our house.
I probably sent 4 or 5, are you guys okay, and no response. So it kind of gave me a kind of a sick feeling in my stomach that something wasn't right.
And Joe's instinct was right. Stephanie and her children were smack in the middle of a deadly F4 tornado, with winds peaking at 174 miles an hour.
It was like watching a slow motion film. Debris was everywhere, the house was flying apart.
As she covered her children with her body, a 20-foot steel beam fell directly on Stephanie's legs, crushing them both at once. And without warning, a second tornado struck.
I remember saying to myself, are you kidding me? And now we're exposed. You know, we don't have the protection of a basement.
Leaving Stephanie trapped in debris, but her children remarkably unscathed.
I'm dialing 911. Nothing. I'm trying Joe's number. Nothing. And I realize it's just that moment of clarity that all the towers are gone. And there's no way to reach anyone.
In that moment, she realized her survival depended on her children finding help.
I was like, I can't leave you. And then she was like, you gotta go. And so I ran across the street, not knowing that I'd see her again. So scared. I felt like my kids are out. They're safe. I did my job. I don't pray for myself ever. But I'm asking, if there is a God in heaven, at this point, I need your help because I'm done.
Dominic and Reese managed to find help, but it took multiple vehicles and even a helicopter to get Stephanie to the hospital.
In that 2.5 hour time frame, my legs were severed and I had the 8 broken ribs and a punctured lung and lost 50% of my blood.
Doctors had to work fast, amputating both legs in order to save Stephanie's life.
I cried for the loss. But after that 10 minutes of my pity party, I guess, I dried it up and said, you know, all right, what are we gonna do? We're gonna change the story. You know, there was a message I had to get through. So we're gonna figure out what that is. And so we did.
With her positive attitude, Stephanie went through intense rehab, learning to walk with prosthetics.
They told me I wouldn't walk for a year. And I was up in 2 months.
But basic prosthetics have limitations, and Stephanie wanted to remain the active mom she always was. So she began to advocate for herself and other amputees.
To me, that was ludicrous to not think that I wouldn't be active.
Because of her activism, Stephanie received the gift of a lifetime from President Obama, the X3, the world's most technologically advanced prosthetics.
I just started crying. I mean, it was just a surreal moment. This is not your standard equipment. You can pretty much do any activity with the sensors that are inside this knee. It has like its own brain, as a computer would be. Now we need to make sure that it's available for everyone.
And her work doesn't stop there. She created the Stephanie Decker Foundation and teamed up with the organization Nubability.
They teach kids how to play sports that are missing limbs. When we're swinging, you want to make sure you're level swing all the way through, okay? We want them to understand that they can do absolutely anything. There you go.
My mom helped so many people, and it's awesome.
She is the best mom in the world.
I said before the tornado, I married up, and it's way up now. She's pretty special.
People always say, do you wish you could turn back the clock? Absolutely not. I am a much better person today than I ever was 4 years ago, and I wouldn't change that.
It was fashion blogger Lauren Scruggs who gained the support of millions with her fairy tale triumph of love over tragedy. On a December night, Lauren accepted an invitation to look at Christmas lights from above in a family friend's propeller plane. But she had an unsettling feeling in the air.
I was in the middle of the flight and I just got this feeling of like something is not right. Something bad is gonna happen.
Lauren's feelings were right. When they landed, she exited the plane and was struck by the spinning propeller.
A young fashion model and online blogger is in serious condition after getting her hand caught in the propeller of a small plane.
The plane was still on because someone was gonna come on after me. So as I was getting out, I was hit kind of down this whole side of my body, so through my head and face, and lost my left hand as well. I was in the hospital for about 3 weeks, and a year after that, I was just in physical therapy every day.
Lauren received a prosthetic arm and eye and faced many challenges.
I've definitely struggled through it. I've been like, man, today I really miss my hand, and today is just hard. I just was afraid that I lost all beauty and attraction. I had amazing family and friends just to encourage me to get out of the house and take it day by day, 12 hours at a time.
And she didn't let the accident stop her from being a force in the online beauty community, where she inspires others with her strength.
My accident changed my view of beauty so much. I think I used to hold so much value in it, and that kind of defined who I was. And afterwards, I realized beauty truly is so internal.
What makes Lauren's story interesting is that she turned it into something positive. This was a woman who did not put all of her self-worth in her beauty or her fashion blog. She was so much more than that and continues to be so much more than that.
While sharing her story of survival and triumph, Lauren fell in love and married E! News co-host Jason Kennedy.
I think he is just genuine, always encouraging me so much and just loving me through all the hurdles.
Staying positive, Lauren actually believes her accident may have been a blessing in disguise.
There have been so many things that have happened since this accident that are so positive. I didn't want to put myself in the place of being a victim.
Lauren has authored 2 books and is passionate about helping others with prosthetics.
We want to bring hope and restore dignity and ignite faith in girls and women that have lost an arm or a leg. And women just feeling like comfortable in their own bodies is so important.
She was someone who was not going to let an accident bring her down, and she's incredibly strong.
Lauren proved that she was just a woman of extraordinary character.
As an Olympic figure skater, Scott Hamilton was a great athlete, but off the ice, he's an even greater champion. After winning Olympic gold in 1984, the beloved figure skater has worn many hats.
Oh, yes, Scott Hamilton.
He loves it, and they love him.
Becoming an author, a sports commentator, and a producer. And he is no stranger to hardship.
I have a unique hobby of collecting life-threatening illness. I survived cancer in 97. The fear was extraordinary. It was unbelievable.
But that didn't hold him back. Scott beat the cancer and returned to the ice.
As early as I can remember, you know, I really liked being in front of people. Skating gave me a perfect venue to be kind of center of attention.
But 7 years later, illness struck Scott again.
I was diagnosed with a pituitary brain tumor. I did radiation, and then it came back 6 years later in 2010, and that time I did surgery.
Never letting his illness slow him down, Scott has found countless ways to give back. The Scott Hamilton Cares Foundation provides support to cancer patients and their families.
He is a true example of maintaining a positive attitude in an impossible situation.
Tragically, in the fall of 2016, Scott's brain tumor returned for the third time.
The first thing I thought when they told me it was back is like, I gotta get strong. This is round 4. You know, I've done it 3 times. You know, round 4 may be a little more challenging, but as a skater, I know that a triple lutz is a little harder than a double lutz, but you do it. You deal with what you got, and then you just move forward.
Coming up, meet a hero mom who made an incredible sacrifice for her best friend.
She asked me if I would take her girls. Without hesitation, I said, of course.
Welcome back to People Icons. It's our look at real life heroes and survivors. And we ask, how far would you go to help your best friend? A Buffalo, New York woman learned the answer to that question about herself when her best friend faced a tragic illness.
Lily, can you go check on the bigs?
On a typical weekday morning, the Ruffino household is buzzing with activity.
Daddy's making pancakes!
The six girls in the house have known each other for almost their entire lives, even though they're not actually related. And it's their mother's friendship that brought them all together.
Liz and I met in the fifth grade. We bonded instantly, and our bond carried out through our whole lives.
Liz was a perfect best friend for Laura. Our kids played together. She was an amazing person, kind of person you always want to be around. So
she was my person.
Yeah.
But in August of 2014, the unimaginable happened.
When Liz first got sick, she was taken to the hospital, and they instantly said that she had 13 brain tumors. It was hard to believe, right? Because she was 39 years old, healthy. She would never cry about it. She was the most positive, strong woman I've ever met.
When it became clear that Liz, a single mom, didn't have much time left, she asked her best friend, Laura, for the ultimate favor.
She asked me if I would take her girls. Without hesitation, I said, of course.
In April 2015, Liz lost her battle with brain cancer.
That was the hardest thing. I just could not imagine her not with us.
Laura, Rico, and their daughters, Bella and Grace, welcome Liz's four girls, Tara, Simona, Ella, and Lily, into their lives.
It just shows how incredibly generous and brave the Ruffinos are. Laura and Rico were a family of four. Suddenly, they became a family of eight.
When the girls moved in, we gave up our rooms. Bella slept in the office, which we made a bedroom and put a door. And I slept in the couch and put my clothes in my mom's closet.
We would all shower in mom's bathroom, and then all four of them and my dad would share the kids' bathroom.
Oh, yeah.
It was chaos.
The whole transition was hard for everyone, but this is our journey. This was our payoff.
Thanks to generous donations from their community, Laura and Rico were able to convert their garage into extra bedrooms.
The most supportive thing that has happened to us is our friends started a You Caring site, so people all over the world have supported us financially.
The donations have made life with six kids a little easier, but no less chaotic.
Who's got what activity today? One at a time.
They're amazing, amazing young girls.
Oh, I remember what I'm missing.
But goes without saying, I feel outnumbered. There is nothing guy in the house.
Does anybody have a hair tie?
Maybe I have one on my wrist. Maybe it's
okay,
a
great unit for
seven females, yeah. You can't find a hair tie.
It is a big deal, it is a lot. But we got this. We can do this. We're doing it. This is our new normal. This is like our modern family.
This is an amazing story. What Laura did is something that you want to think you would do for your best friend. When someone needs you, you're there for them.
Laura and Rico officially adopted Liz's four daughters in 2016, but they make it a priority to remember Liz every single day.
That the universe phone so we could talk to her through it.
Any night if we miss her, we'll dial her old phone number.
And then we'll talk to her about, hello, Mom, miss you so much and stuff.
The bond and connection that these girls have with each other and our girls are so strong. They are like sisters forever.
I'm really thankful for my mom and my dad for taking me in. And I'm more thankful than I could ever count.
Our new family is like amazing. Like, we're all supportive for each other.
I love them so much.
I love you too.
You just tell each other that we are sisters, and now we actually are.
Every day, I say, I'm so proud of you to every one of them for their strength, their love. It's a blessing, and I feel honored that I can fill this role.
Coming up, heroes don't only come in human form. Meet Sarge, the miracle dog who came to his owner's rescue. And later, Jamie Foxx takes on the role of hero. And this time, it's not in the movies.
He was inside on fire. We pulled him out. We need to send the ambulance, please.
Welcome back to People Icons, Heroes and Survivors. There is a reason people say that dog is man's best friend. In fact, you're about to meet two perfect four-legged examples of just that.
Meet Sarge, the four-legged hero who's also a little bit of a troublemaker.
Sarge is a big, big dog. He thinks that he's a lap dog, but he's really this 135-pound black lab.
Sarge, right off the bat, was a high-strung dog and loved to tear up stuff.
Sarge couldn't keep his nose out of trouble.
He destroyed everything that he came into contact with. He tore up throw pillows
and hammock pillows.
He chewed the rattan off of the seats of the chairs.
Ate the side out of my Suzuki Jeep.
He would pull the toilet paper off the roll and wind it all the way around the house.
Sarge was getting on Merle's last nerve.
Every day he was saying we were going to have to do something with this dog.
And on a frigid January day, while Leslie was downstairs in the house, Merle stepped outside to grab something from his truck. What Merle didn't know was that Sarge was about to save his life.
Last thing I can remember is hitting the sidewalk.
Merle suffered a massive heart attack, and Sarge sprung into action, helping him regain consciousness.
When I did come back to, Sarge was laying beside me, squatted down, and he was licking my face, was lifting my head up off the sidewalk.
Sarge knew he needed to help Merle into the house and managed to use his body weight to lift Merle and guide him indoors.
Sarge was in the house and he was barking. We knew that there was something wrong. And at that point, we found Merle.
Merle was able to get to the hospital in time to save his life.
When we got him to the hospital, Merle's heart functioning was about 7%.
I had a Widowmaker heart attack.
A lot of the hospital doctors called him the miracle man because he just was able to survive something that most people would not have survived.
And he owes it all to his hero, Sarge.
We started really getting some notoriety for Sarge because he was Merle's first responder.
It's funny because Merle admits that Sarge was on his last nerve before this whole thing happened. But as he started recovering, Sarge was there every day.
He went from being on the blacklist to the gold list. Sarge saved my life and he's my hero.
Meet Pooch, another four-legged hero.
My name is Zach Scow. I'm the executive director and founder of Marley's Mutt's Dog Rescue. And this is Hooch, my big orange bear.
Named after the French Mastiff in the movie Turner and Hooch.
Back off, Hooch!
This Hooch uses his charm to constantly help others. His heroism was even awarded at the 2016 American Humane Hero Dog Awards.
Hooch.
He's the most loving creature you'll ever come across, which is pretty remarkable considering what he's been through.
Before Hooch became a hero to others, he had hurdles of his own to overcome.
I got a call from the shelter. And she said, we've got a French Mastiff. His ears have been cut off, and he's got viral pneumonia. He's gravely ill, and he's very, very skinny.
Without hesitation, Zach rescued Hooch and immediately took him to the veterinarian.
And that's when Dr. Willis went to move his tongue aside for the intubation tube, he discovered that there just was no tongue there. I mean, it's severed all the way at the base with a sharp instrument. It was clear that his ears and his tongue had been cut out at the same time.
Oh boy.
The abuse was cruel and unusual, but Zach had to be strong for Hooch to help him survive.
The feeding tube was in for a couple of weeks and he was starting to gain weight. The pneumonia had subsided, so it was starting to look like we were making progress.
Hooch's next move was to join the other rescued pups at Marley's Mutts.
Putting him in a situation where there was other dogs, I think helped lower his guard, and he's opened himself up completely.
Zach decided that Hooch's story could help others, so they got to work.
Barks and Books is a program that we developed for kids. Kids can come and they can read with their dogs. These kids making progress in their life via the dogs.
And Hooch doesn't stop there. He also visits elderly homes and homeless shelters.
I've never not seen somebody have an incredibly impactful experience after they've interacted with Hooch.
Hooch is the very definition of man's best friend.
He has faced a lot of adversity in his life. He's faced a lot of really fearful situations, and he's triumphed over them. And he's done it with love.
Coming up, it's Blake Shelton to the rescue.
That's so quintessential Blake, like he's gonna be there and help out a friend.
And later, meet a super kid with a heart of gold.
It's amazing to see how far he comes.
Being your son is amazing.
Welcome back to People Icons, Heroes and Survivors. You can find heroes everywhere. In the last few years, a handful of celebrities have gone above and beyond helping those in need, and sometimes even risking their own lives to save others.
Brad Pitt, Heidi Klum, Tom Cruise, and Adam Levine. Just a few of the Hollywood A-listers who have played hero on the big screen and off. Oscar-winning actor and singer Jamie Foxx didn't hesitate to take action when he saw a pickup truck flipped over and engulfed in flames.
He was inside on fire. We pulled him out. We need to send an ambulance, please.
It was a really huge moment of just showing his humanity.
You're handsome, you're famous, you're rich, you have an Oscar. Oh, and you also save people from fires.
The Grammy winner explained how it all went down.
I got a chance to cut him out of there before the car went up, so it was just one of those incredible moments.
And if you're driving around in Oklahoma, Blake Shelton is your guy. The country superstar helped some young men near his home who were stuck in a mud hole. In 2015, Shelton used his tractor to pull a truck of four guys to safety. Blake was also in Oklahoma when he came to the aid of Rojo Hartman, who was stuck in floodwaters. Hartman later told the local NBC affiliate he couldn't believe his eyes.
My wife called me. I said, Blake Shelton pulled me out, and he's going to go ahead and bring me on home. I said, you better slick up.
That's so quintessential Blake. Like, he's going to be there and help out a friend and probably make a few jokes while he's doing it.
In 2011, it was Kate Winslet to the rescue. The Oscar winner was vacationing on Necker Island with friend Sir Richard Branson and his family when the house they were staying in caught fire. Kate moved quickly and helped her children and Branson's 90-year-old mother, Eve, out of danger.
In disastrous moments like that, you do the strangest thing. So I started to put on a bra, and I thought, that's going to take me too long. Off came the bra, over the t-shirt, grabbed the children, and picked up Granny.
The entire house was destroyed, but everyone got out safely, thanks in part to Winslet's quick thinking. And while the Titanic storm may have saved Eve Branson's life, she remains modest about being a hero.
No, I didn't save her life. I carried her down the stairs, is the truth of it.
Everybody already loved Kate Winslet. Now everybody loves her even more.
To, you know, rush in and grab someone in a fire situation is stuff that firemen do, not A-list Hollywood superstars.
Whether it's winning an Oscar or a Golden Globe, all of these stars have given their greatest performances saving lives.
Coming up, meet Zion, the first child to ever receive a bilateral hand transplant.
Welcome back to People Icons. We're exploring real-life stories of heroism and survival. This young boy is only 10 years old, but he has the kind of grit and grace that would be remarkable at any age.
I am Zion Harvey, and I'm 10 years old. I like football and video games.
He seems like an ordinary 10-year-old boy, except Zion's story is incredible.
I go to therapy 3 times a week, but I used to go every day.
I'm doing it.
I know. Really good.
After having to have both his hands and feet amputated, Zion has become the first child ever to receive a bilateral hand transplant, a pioneering surgery.
When I first found out Zion was sick, it was very quick and it was very devastating. He was diagnosed with sepsis, like a staph infection, which caused his kidneys to fail. He ended up losing blood flow, and he had to have a quadruple amputation of both hands and both feet.
To make matters worse, Zion also needed a kidney transplant, but he had a very special donor.
When I was 4, my mom gave me her kidney.
It wasn't a decision, it was a no-brainer.
Over the next 4 years, Zion learned to walk with prosthetics and live without hands. Meanwhile, doctors placed him on a list for a pediatric hand transplant, the first of its kind in the world. The Children's Hospital of Philadelphia began documenting Zion's life. And it wasn't until the age of 8 that he received the news that would change his life.
We got the call that he was going to be receiving hands.
Bittersweet news, because his hands were a gift from a family who donated them after their own child's death.
That day was a very big day.
With a team of anesthesiologists and nurses on hand, 12 surgeons operated on Zion for over 10 hours, attaching the hands to his body.
When I met Zion, I said, why do you want hands? He said, I want to swing on the monkey bars. And why shouldn't he be like another child? We have some good news for you. Your little guy has 2 hands.
It couldn't have went any better, and I couldn't ask for a better result and a better team.
Press the place up a little bit for me.
Everybody there was amazing.
The transplant was a success.
When we did the story, the reaction was amazing. I mean, it's just a story that captures your heart. Zion is so special, and it's one of the things that makes his story so extraordinary.
And the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia has become part of Zion's family.
When we go there, it's usually a full day of testing, biopsies. They do some brain mapping and MRIs just to keep track of his brain function, because parts of his brain that were asleep before are now awake.
As for Zion, he isn't wasting any time making progress. He's already back in school, surrounded by friends.
They don't treat me like I'm some kind of outcast, some kind of weird human. They treat me like I'm a kid who is in school like everybody else.
And doing therapy 3 times a week.
A day of therapy is hard work, but at the end, it all pays off.
This!
I like throwing the football.
and bounce around the basketball.
Oh, make it! Yes!
Zion still has a long way to go, but with his positive attitude and appreciation, the possibilities are endless.
He's always been a fighter, and he always, you know, just keeps at it. He never gives up.
Okay, let me try that one more time.
He's a blessing and a miracle, because it's amazing to see how far he comes.
Here we go. Being your son is amazing.
It is.
And Zion has a message to the family that gave him his hands.
I just want the parents to know thank you. And they're very important in my life and my mom's, and thank you. We love you very much.
We thank you so much for joining us. I hope you'll tune in next week for our next edition of People Icons. Until then, I'm Lara Spencer. Good night.
Dax Shepard and Sophia Black D'Elia on a new Kimmel later tonight.